Back to the Corona impeachment trial, the defense is bent on proving the Chief Justice had no illegal dealings nor illegal sources of income in connection to the properties and bank accounts presented by the prosecution. Let's get an assessment of how the panel is doing so far and how much longer the trial is likely to continue. Joining us this morning is defense team spokesperson Atty. Karen Jimeno and Marikina Representative Miro Quimbo, spokesperson for the prosecution. Good morning.
Morning.
Hi, thank you for joining us. It's day two for the defense, day three today, but give us an assessment first of how the first 2 days have gone for your defense team and how you guys are rolling along.
Well, I think we are doing well so far, and I'm sure that other people have a different view, but just to give a
like this guy.
Summary, first day, we wanted to establish the motive behind the filing of the impeachment complaint, and this addresses some of the allegations in the complaint, such as saying that this is for public accountability and this was filed on behalf of the people. And the testimony of Congressman Tianco showed that this was for political motives, according to his testimony, and because of the interests of no less than the President of the Philippines. And now day two, we go, of course, to first establishing other things related to the SAL and first income. And yesterday the Supreme Court employee was there to testify on other allowances and some income, that not just the basic income which is subject to withholding tax, but some of the income such as allowances that Chief Justice Corona received through the years. And another one would be the sale of the property since 1990, and this was established during the trial. Even if there were questions on the authority of the notary public, first we have to check, is there really no authority by that notary public? We have to trace that person, because this was 20 years ago. But second, under our laws, even if there's a defect in the authority of the notary public, this does not affect the legality and validity of the sale. And the truth of the matter is, as shown by the testimony of the witness, he's been living there since 1990.
All right. Well, let's go to the prosecution now. And one of the question marks that were raised yesterday, Congressman Kim, was the fact that the mere presence of that Supreme Court employee, Ms. Bayuga, was surprising, because you guys as well had subpoenaed or requested for subpoena for some court employees as well, and they were denied because of that court order on February 14th. So what was your reaction when you saw her? And she was one of the people you actually subpoenaed as well.
Well, you know, it's absolutely disappointing. We agree with the point of Senator Francis Pangilinan that obviously the impeachment proceeding, as far as the Supreme Court and documents coming from the Supreme Court are concerned, they will only be willing to let it go or bring it to the Senate Impeachment Court only if the defense needs it. But when the prosecution needs it, they will not release it. Remember, they presented yesterday, Ms. Bayuga presented the Alpha List, which is the income tax returns of all the employees of the Supreme Court for given years that the Chief Justice was there. We requested for the same thing. And in fact, a subpoena was issued. She showed up February 1. She was there, and when she showed up, she said, "I'm sorry, I cannot produce the documents because these are all confidential." Parang it's absolutely double standard. When it is our turn to ask for it, it's confidential, but when it is theirs, it is not. So aside from that, is that the Supreme Court has categorically come up with that resolution on February 14. And in fact, that resolution prohibits its employees, justices, from actually going to court without their consent. Now, it is true that they said that, you know, on matters concerning privileged information. But the problem here is the determination as to what is privileged or not is not done by the Senate. It is done by the Supreme Court themselves. So that when we asked for two process servers, meaning a security guard as well as some technical aide who did the service of the TRO, we were flatly told, "No, I'm sorry, it's privileged." They cannot. They actually showed up initially, but when we were about to present them, sabi nila hindi pwede. Okay. So that is our problem. The getting of documents as well as witnesses was closed for us, but it is absolutely open for the defense.
How were you guys really able to present him, and did you get a consent from the Supreme Court?
Yes, and I guess I'd have to address that. Justice Cuevas read into court yesterday that the prohibition relates to matters that are privileged. It relates to deliberations, such as like the deliberations on voting for a Supreme Court decision. And this is something that is of public record and relates directly to the respondent about his income. So we think it was not covered by the privileged matters, which was prohibited by that resolution. And with respect to the concerns raised by Congressman Miro, they could have filed for a request and gotten the consent of the Supreme Court as a whole, because in this case, you know, the problem is if you just let an employee go there without saying what matters will be covered, then it might also touch into confidential matters, not just relating to Chief Justice Corona, but also to the other Supreme Court justices who have nothing to do with the impeachment.
All right. Well, let's get to the meat of the matter that was the bombshells, basically, that Ms. Bayuga dropped yesterday. She talked about the salary plus allowances totaling to more than $21 million for 10 years. And we still don't have the exact breakdown yet, no, of how much was there per allowances, but she mentioned some particular expenses like cash gift, monthly expense allowance, rice, fringe benefits, and other allowances. And before we got on air, you were actually doing some math on your calculator, Attorney Congressman Quimbo. And what was your assessment from the amounts that were mentioned with regards to what you've seen before in the SAL ends and how you still view the bigger picture now?
Well, first and foremost, we have to do a careful cross-examination of the $20 million that was alleged, because many of the salaries that she actually stated are not being given out by the Supreme Court. So as to whether she's competent to testify on those things is highly doubtful. Secondly, is that even, let's just assume for the sake of argument that in fact he made $21 million in a span of 9 years. Just on the properties alone that he bought, he and his wife bought, that already amounted to almost $32 million. You're looking at 4 condominiums, you're looking at the La Vista property. So dun pa lang, kahit hindi siya kumain, walang bayaran ng kuryente, talagang zero siya na ginastos for 9 years, the money would not have been enough. Nandiyan pa yung $31 million, which is uncovered in 3 accounts. Nandiyan pa yung $37 million, which has to be explained also na time deposits na tinerminate. Nandiyan pa yung dollar accounts, which up to now has been embargoed by the Supreme Court. So, kahit anong pagtingin-tingin natin doon, talagang hindi magkakasya. But even with the expenses, sabihin pa natin, no, yung just on the, to highlight, with the properties that he bought, aside from buying them, he will have to spend. Just for Bellagio alone, based on the condominium juice in Bellagio, he should be paying 21,000 pesos a month just on condominium juice. I mean, everybody knows that. It's not a capital expense. It's something you just, it's a privilege for the upkeep of the wala pang kuryente, wala pang tubig. So, obviously, even with just one unit, 21,000. If you divide the 21 million over 9 years, that's just a little, that's even less than 200,000. So, sa isang condominium pa lang, 21,000 na. Parang tingin namin kahit anong pagbali-bali dyan, at gagawin yan. Ng defense is susubukan nilang pagkasyahin yan. Pero talagang tingin namin, any rational arithmetic, any knowledge of arithmetic will not be able to add up these things.
Well, you're not yet done with Article 2. You haven't rested your case for Article 2. And I guess we're all waiting if there will be more witnesses presented to present more sources of income.
Yes, exactly. That's the point I was going to raise, that this is only one of the pieces of evidence to support Article 2, because this is you know, this is a trial, so you have to go step by step, and you can only present one witness at a time. So our Supreme Court witness, Mrs. Bayuga, is just there to show at least one source of income.
Okay. And one other question that was raised, as well as in social media, people monitoring the development yesterday, was that, so okay, fine, there's allowances, it's this much, but can these allowances be used to buy properties? I mean, because there are specific purposes for food, for whatever, for clothing, and normally you have to show that with receipts as well. You give it back to your employer, that, okay, I spent this on food, representation expense, and it's for that. Can it be used? Is it personal discretion, or is it a law that you cannot use it otherwise?
No, there's really no law limiting you. It's called allowances because there's a presumption when they drafted rules for compensation that you, of course, spend for these things, but it doesn't mean that automatically, if you get 10,000, it goes directly to for instance, rice allowance mm-hmm. has to go directly to rice. I was also an employee before, mm-hmm. and that was in the breakdown of my compensation receipt, that mm-hmm. I have rice allowance, I have transportation allowance, mm-hmm. but it doesn't mean
but
that I automatically use it, mm-hmm. because right. if my parents are paying for it, then I don't have to use it, I can keep it. But those are presumptions that you have right. to spend for mm-hmm. those things, and this is how much they're giving you for mm-hmm. those.
And as well, since it was clearly much bigger than his salary, there's a question of taxing. Were the allowances supposed to be taxed? Can they be taxed? Or were taxes paid?
Well, yes. This is, of course, yeah, they are taxable income. Mm-hmm. And the question of whether they were paid mm-hmm. for in terms of the tax liability, mm-hmm. I think it's something for determination, but I don't think this is the proper form. We have the Bureau okay. of Internal Revenue okay. to look into this, mm-hmm. and I don't think we need to saddle our senator judges right. with
is that. Is that something that you think should be dealt with by the BR or by this impeachment case?
Well, that's the strategy. The strategy is on the part of the defense is to let's not care if we violate tax laws or anything. Why? Because many of those things, anyway, are not covered by the articles of impeachment. Mm-hmm. So let's try to put in as much as we can into the piggy bank, even if many of these things have find no legal basis, even if these are violations of laws. Mm-hmm. Anyway, we just need to survive the impeachment. If there's a tax violation, let's face that afterwards. That's obviously the strategy. And, you know, I want to just go back, is that I worked in government too. I headed an agency, and I had constantly had to deal with the commission on audit. He just in the list of items that he stated, he had like 3 or 4 ratas, which is representation and transportation allowance. Mm-hmm. As soon as, under all government regulations, as soon as you have a service car and that the gasoline is paid for by government, mm-hmm. hindi ka na pwedeng tumanggap ng ta, yung transportation. Mm-hmm. If you receive one representation allowance from one agency, you cannot receive anymore. When you talked about extraordinary expenses, under the law, those are expenses that you have to be able to only access by virtue of reimbursements.
So liquidating them.
Liquidated, yeah. So if you could say it just keeps on raising more issues and questions. Mm-hmm. And that, you know, sabi ko nga, in trying to fend off the charges of the articles of impeachment, the Chief Justice is actually admitting to so many more violations. Mm-hmm. But do they care? I don't think they do
but
right now.
But are those
now.
Violations impeachable?
That's exactly. Yeah. Exactly. That yeah. is the strategy. No. The strategy of the defense is, that's fine. I mean, you know, anyway, it's not covering the articles of impeachment. Mm-hmm. Let's just survive this. Never mind if there are other laws or he opens himself to many other violations. But sometimes it's the irony, or it's not a matter before the impeachment court. But I think in terms of policy, what does that leave us with? A Chief Justice who survives impeachment but is absolutely tainted in terms of violating so many other laws? That's just a question being raised in on the street.
Well, response.
First of all, let's look at the first, we're trying to establish here, source of income. So the only question here is, did he receive that income? Because this is what we're showing, that first, where did he get the capability to buy the properties in relation to the declarations in the SAL-N, no? And the questions as to whether yung policy nung whether yun dapat i-reimburse yan, we have to look into whether this is really a standing policy of the Supreme Court. That do they ask for reimbursement receipts, or is this something that's automatically given? Because based on the evidence, it seems that this was in practice, even not just with Chief Justice Corona, but for all the justices and previous Chief Justices.
Okay.
They just give this allowance as a form of compensation, and it's written there. And so, why will we blame him again for these things? Like, standard practice that has gone on before he became Chief Justice. And then with respect to the income tax, are we saying again that there's a violation when in fact there's no assessment from the BIR? So these are things, of course, I agree that if there's a violation, it has to be looked into. Mm-hmm. But then again, following rules of procedure, we have to stick with the impeachment complaint because that's what we're dealing with right now. If they find probable cause for another impeachment, then they can file that next time, right? But here, we should not confuse the issues. We should stick with the allegations in the impeachment complaint. And first of all, there's no violation that we see right now. And if, even if there is, they have to address this next time in some other complaint.
And you still have your day in court, so to speak, to cross-examine Ms. Bayuga today. What do we expect in terms of how you intend to, you know, break it down and cross-examine her today?
Well, we'll try to elicit Well, honestly, I don't want to reveal that too much
okay,
right
I'm
now.
I'm just trying. It's my job. Trying to get as much as I can out of you.
No, but seriously, I mean, obviously, we need to be able to unmask that 21 million that supposedly he made. Even, like I said, even assuming that he actually made 21 million and he never spent a single thing on a bar of soap or some food item, baka kumakain sila. I think what is important is that even assuming that he received all of that and saved that, it's not going to be enough. And I think that the source of concern here, or what we will try to do on cross-examination, is in the same breath what we did with their witness who supposedly purchased the property in Marikina. Mm-hmm. The properties that were purchased in 1990, mm-hmm. it's been 22 years. They have not, it was purchased in 1990, but mysteriously it was declared in 1992 in the salon of the Chief Justice. Mm-hmm. The titles remain in the name of Mrs. Corona. The tax declaration remain in the name of Mrs. Corona. It doesn't matter. I mean, they said that he's been in possession for quite a long time. So are we now telling, is the Chief Justice telling all the landowners in this country where their properties are squatted by somebody else na, ay, 30 years sila, sila na may-ari nun? Possession. I mean, possession never ripens into ownership. That's very, very clear. So as far as we're concerned, the witness that they presented yesterday, supposedly to exonerate the violation of non-declaration, I think was not able to establish that. If at all, he was a cousin, he had proximity to the, and we feel like the sale was not actually genuine.
All right, so we'll expect your cross-exam today. And for the defense, you're presenting more witnesses today already?
I'd first like to address, of course, the issues raised with respect to Mr. Demetrio Vicente. Mm-hmm. First, we have to look at this in perspective. No, mm-hmm. This was a sale 22 years ago. Mm-hmm. So are we saying that several years ago, 22 years ago, they foresaw that, oh, he's going to be Chief Justice someday. His salon is going to be an issue. So let's hide this property. I mean, first of all, this was a sale of two properties as well. And Mr. Vicente is the second cousin of Chief Justice, not the sister also of Mrs. Corona, who also sold the same property, who up to now, whose title has also not been transferred to Mr. Vicente for his negligence. No. So the point is, this is not an indication that the sale is dubious, because if you look at the circumstances, ang layo naman na, why would also the sister of Mrs. Corona allow herself to give that land away and let him live there since 1990? She's not even a public officer. Her husband is not a public officer. Hindi naman issue yung sale and sa kanila. Why would they do the same thing? The thing is, kasi hindi naman ganun kalaki yung halaga ng pera na yan. Why would he also try to hide that from his sale, no? Na 22 years ago pa. So that's the point here. And also, yung mga issues on whether yung lack of transfer ng title. I was a teacher of sales in College of Law before. And this lack of transfer of title is not really an indication that you don't own the property. What matters is the validity of the sale. Now, meron silang deed of sale in this case.
And
physical possession is also an indication of ownership. Mm-hmm. And yung question nga dun sa notarization, it does not affect validity and legality of the sale.
Mm-hmm. Right. Just briefly.
Oh, sige, last year.
Last. It has been 22 years. Any person who buys a property, meron kang heirs, tinanong Senate President sa kanya mismo, may anak ka ba? Ibig sabihin, tinatanong Senate President, hindi ka man lang na-concern, hindi mo nililipat yung property sa pangalan mo kung buyer ka. How much was the cost of transfer? Less than 3,000 pesos. He could have paid 3,000 pesos in 1990. When in fact, it could have been so expedient. Sinong buyer ang ayaw ilipat sa pangalan niya? Pangalawa, I disagree. The notary was actually shown na hindi siya authorized. So it entirely affects the sale. Unlike any other sale, the sale of land, you cannot convey or there is no transfer if it does not go through a public document. So in our minds, there is a defective sale simply because there probably may have been no sale to begin with.
Move on to last two, who you're expecting today.
So
go ahead.
With respect to yung legality nga, the law requires public document because between the two sellers, even if it's not in a public document, kahit nga hindi pa pinanotarize yan, first, it is valid as between the parties. What happens is it's unenforceable against third parties. Ibig sabihin, pag may naghabol, and that's the only proof you have, they can say, no, that's not binding on me. Binili ko na yan. So that's the point. Yeah. But the other one yung sinasabi nilang transfer tax. we have to take into account, yung, of course, I'm questioning them, bakit hindi niya na nga binayaran, but that's his negligence, and we shouldn't blame it on Chief Justice Corona, but the amount before, what, close to 3,000, was not really 3,000 in today's money. That's 1990. And I'm sorry to be technical here, pero I was thinking for myself then, that's not exactly just 3,000 at that time, because if you go by inflation, real real value, using yung consumer price index, it could be around 7,000 to 8,000 pesos today. And, you know, if...
but he had 3 million.
Conservative.
On 1990, he had 3
no,
million pesos.
No, but he bought
pesos.
Two properties. Why would he
so
not
why would
also
you not transfer?
Transfer
the property in your name? I mean...
You know, gusto niya.
Yeah, but I... That's my... Yeah.
I don't know.
But,
it's yeah, mind-boggling exactly. For most.
Yeah, but then, you know,
unless
I...
there was no transfer.
No, no, but he was been... He's been living there. But what's
just
the
like many
of
the informal squatters, they live in certain areas.
But there's no sale there. Why would he have to pay?
Yeah.
No? And the thing is,
but he's done, right? He's done. You've done cross-examining him, so he's not going to be coming back anymore.
And I've come across a lot of cases ng double sale when I was teaching. And ganun talaga, I don't know kung anong problema, but mga Pinoy, may tendency sila na ganyan. Kaya ang daming cases ng double sale. Nabenta na sa kanila, they neglect to transfer it to themselves just because they think, ah, nakatira na ako dito, wala na mangyayari. And then the seller, pag nakita nasa kanila pa yung title, sells it to another person. Oh, so yun yung nagiging problema.
Alright, well, moving on to today, who do we expect today for today from the defense to add your witnesses?
Well, today, we have other witnesses, but I don't think I can give a
surprise
categorical
anybody. Anybody from the Supreme
it's
Court?
It's also hard to say.
Because there's been rumors that Attorney Midas Marquez might testify.
I'm not sure kung kasama siya sa witnesses because he went there yesterday to give moral support to Mrs. Bayuga because he's the court administrator.
Right, okay.
And I don't know if he's going to be a witness because he's not in the lineup.
Right.
So, but it's hard to give a categorical statement because sometimes they're there pero hindi naman nakakaupo sa witness stand.
So we'll all be surprised once again today. So thank you once again
for
joining us,
thank
Congressman Quimbo and Attorney Jimeno. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.